that.
Oh,
Happy
man.
Easter.
He is risen.
Or he's risen. Like DJ Clue. Desert Storm mixtape. Jesus back, y'all. Yo, them old DJs was crazy.
Yo, the reverb is for real.
Oh my God. Welcome to the Kind of Sleepy podcast. The 1996 edition. When we going back to Rockefeller, Murder Inc., and Rough Riders. Putting out mixtapes all at the same time.
Right.
And they put out one on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Of course, Rockefeller put theirs out on Sunday because that's when Jesus rose, and it's Easter Sunday, and the Rock is in the building, and, you know, Hove is back.
Rock is in the building.
Hove is back.
Hove is back.
You know? You know what? I don't know if that was sacrilegious, but it felt like it.
Nah. Jesus knows my heart.
He does. And I think God has a sense of humor. Matter of fact,
he has to.
Considering
this life, he has to.
Considering my 2019, God has a huge sense of humor.
Yo, God is a son of a bitch. I'll tell you that much.
Whoa. My guy. Pump your brakes.
Yo, we can go there.
Pump your brakes.
We can go there. Like,
pump your brakes, my guy.
We can definitely go there on some religiousness, but
that was,
you know, I'm about, I know I'll be ready to upset the entire black community, have everybody knocking down my door.
But the thing is, and I talked to somebody about this earlier, I said, Kanye has proven to us that we are the most forgiving race of Negroes in the history of the world.
No, some of us are.
Man, Kanye apparently had a service today. You know, Kanye's been doing this Kanye church thing out there in Wyoming where he has white people doing a choir and, you know, apparently he do some gospel slaps or whatnot. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And black folks is all on his tip on Twitter. And I'm like, yo, here's my thing. I don't dislike Kanye. I don't like Kanye anymore. What I will say about Kanye is that I'm not ready to let him back into the cookout. But I'm not going to throw him to them because I'm one of those people that believe that, you know, we shouldn't just hand over our folks to the folks.
See, this is where we agree to disagree.
Okay.
I'm done with new Kanye.
Facts.
I am done with new Kanye. Now, don't get me wrong. You know, I will still bump the albums that I've already paid for. You know, College Dropout. Can still get banged in the whip, but that's about it. I mean, I'm not checking
anything new. I don't really want to hear
anything after 808 and Heartbreaks is trash.
I'm not gonna lie, Life of Pablo was kind of dope. Life of Pablo,
he had a couple bangers on there, but still, I wasn't paying money for it. I got it from my ubiquitous clandestine sources.
Now, but I got Life of Pablo from the legit source.
Okay.
I hate to use the term bootleg, but I didn't necessarily bootleg that one.
Ubiquitous clandestine sources.
I didn't use my ubiquitous clandestine sources for that one. I actually have a Tidal subscription.
Okay.
Because I believe black entrepreneurship is important.
Very true. Very true.
And so I did listen to Life of Pablo on there. We're gonna get into that title, Jay-Z, whole Carter family bag in a second.
Yo, can I get into that bag?
Let's get into that in a second. Hold your mew while I shout.
Okay.
So, but no, like Kanye, like everybody was like, seems like everybody forgot that Kanye said that our ancestors, who we're gonna talk about as well this episode, decided that slavery was a good thing for them, like it was their best option. People forgot that. I haven't forgotten that.
Me neither.
I haven't forgotten that he was up in the Oval Office shucking and jiving for what's his name? Individual One. Yeah. He was shucking and jiving for him. Haven't forgot any of that. So, you know.
I think, you know, we live in a world where people tend to have, you know, the 30-second attention span. Mm. My span's a little bit longer.
Yeah.
And I'm petty. So,
he's
I mean, I, you know, definitely am not one to forgive and forget. You can ask anybody out there that knows me. I am not one to forgive, and I do not forget. My memory runs long and strong. Mm. Pause. Yeah.
Well, sir.
But that being said, I definitely haven't forgotten about Kanye. I definitely haven't, forgotten how bad he made us look, and how, like, as a representative, of the culture, how he turned on us. And so for that fact alone, I'm really not checking for Kanye. He's out there on his own island. Let him be there. I certainly don't wish harm on him. I don't wish ill of him, but I'm not checking for him, especially in the areas of life that matter to me, like truly. When we talk about issues of trying to fight for people of black and brown persuasion, I am my thing is that, my brother, if you want to get in this fight and you want to have a voice and an opinion, then I'm gonna need you to pick up some books and some newspapers, and educate yourself. Rather than just trying to just try to BS your way through talking some nonsense. I need you to, if you're gonna have that platform to go into the Oval Office, I need you to go in there, not as I got some ideas that we should have the dopest planes. I need you to go in there like, we need real criminal justice reform, and this is what it looks like. And by the way, here are the three of the utmost experts in that field that you should be speaking to.
My biggest thing with Kanye, bro, you too old to be on TV acting like it's just you and me.
True.
I get it. Can't nobody tell you nothing, bro, but come on, man. You too old for that shit, man.
Right.
You too old for that shit.
Right.
And given your pedigree, man, you can't. I just don't understand how the child of two activists got here.
He got money. I mean, you can't use that as an excuse, because, again, kind of foreshadowing where we're going. Look at Jay-Z.
It's the Rock.
This dude, came from nothing.
He built something.
The gutter of Brooklyn, and now, like, I mean, damn it, he could be the mayor.
He's the king of the world,
right? This dude is, you can't just say the fact that he got money, so he's exempt from, really kind of knowing
the reality of
the situation. No. There are plenty of people out there, plenty of activists out there that have money. Look at Common. Look at Talib. I mean, even just staying in the hip hop world, we have people out there. Look at KRS-One.
Right.
I mean, you have guys that have been out here in this game fighting this fight for years.
Right.
And they have built a platform. So we can't just say that just because, Kanye got money, so he kind of left the reservation. That's not acceptable.
And having money don't make you an idiot. I'm just saying.
It makes it more feasible for you to be an idiot.
It makes it easier for you to live in a sheltered bubble.
Yeah.
It makes it easier for you to ignore the plights and pleas of the common man. But having money don't make you an idiot, and it should never make you forget where you came from.
That's true.
Let's leave that alone, though. Let's move on to...
Did we even do the introductions?
I think I said welcome to the Kind of TV podcast.
Okay.
If I didn't,
yeah, we
9 minutes in. Welcome, motherfuckers.
enjoy yourself.
Right. Thank you. Who do I have sitting to my left, by the way? Sorry, we just dove straight in.
It's your boy B Wood, aka your favorite DJ's favorite DJ, aka I'm tired as hell today because I just drove back from Maryland, my Maryland.
Oh man.
So
was it a good drive though?
It was a good drive. Good. Coming back was cool. Going up there,
you probably went during the week and the traffic was trash.
I went Friday.
Oh.
We left at dark o'clock and got there in the, like, literally the middle of the day, and there was still traffic getting into D.C. Like,
you left
on a holiday.
Mm.
So,
it happens.
It's
D.C. though.
Man, it was D.C.
It is D.C.
But yeah, it was a great trip. Shout out to my family. Those that I got to see and those that I didn't get to see.
I need to get up to D.C. again this summer.
Let's do it.
Yeah, I'm going July. I might go in June or July. I'm not sure yet.
July. My cousin's having her 50th birthday, and I'm on the wheels. So
let's make it happen.
Let's do it.
I'll be there in July. Say no more.
All right.
We're gonna make it happen.
There we go.
So yeah, let's dive into this. First of all, Game of Thrones.
Nah.
You don't want to talk about Game of Thrones?
I can't, dude. I don't watch that nonsense. That's some white people mess. I don't know.
I like Game of Thrones.
So here's my thing.
Okay.
First of all, I'm not gonna yuck anybody's yum.
Okay.
If that's what you if you into that, you know, cool.
I had never seen an episode until last year, and I binge watched the whole thing, and I got attached to some of the characters. I think if you actually watched it, you'd like it.
So I tried to watch the first two episodes.
It's the third one where you actually get hooked.
I couldn't get past it was in like somewhere, and then it was like in this Winterland thing.
Westeros and the North.
I'm not a fantasy dude. So that's just.
And see, I'm not either, but once I got to episode 3, it's when I started getting invested in the characters.
I tapped out too early.
The characters are so well written that once you really get into them, you really kind of get, I'm not going to say emotionally invested, of course, but you start feeling invested in some of the characters. That's why people say, you know, they're team so-and-so and team so-and-so. And right. I kind of get that now as somebody who is now looking for, the new episode to come out. You know?
No, I completely get it, and you know, knowing HBO and the quality of the programming that they put out, you know, it makes sense that this show has taken off in the way that it has. But man, damn it, they just lost me from the beginning, and I just had to pull the ripcord. I was like, I can't follow this.
I got it. Now, do you watch The Chi?
Oh, hell yeah!
Okay,
Require viewing.
Now let's touch on that one.
Let's get in there.
I haven't seen episode 3 yet.
Okay,
that one drops today.
Okay,
drops today.
All right.
So, what do you think so far about season 2?
Do you think
that maybe they lost some steam? I mean, it's only 2 episodes in, so I can't say that. But
yeah, it's 2 episodes in, but I to be honest with you, I don't think it's lost steam, man. I think you got to kind of let the story develop, and mm-hmm. I think it's developing it in a fascinating way. You know, the way that, you know, what's happening with some of these characters and kind of how it's picked up from last year. I mean, it's phenomenal. First of all, I'm completely fascinated with the Brandon character.
Mm.
You know, this dude, I think that's the dude with the baby mamas. Mm-hmm. So that's a fascinating storyline right off the jump. He gets kicked out of his house, and dude has to try to, figure out, okay, where am I going to live? But you think about that. That's a real plight that a lot of people face.
He's trying to finally be he's trying to finally be an active parent to a child that he has that's nearby.
But see, the other thing is that he's actually he's being forced into actually growing up.
Yeah, and a lot of guys were forced into that because of, you know, either their wayward dick or the world itself.
Right.
One or the other. Now, luckily, I kind of grew up long before I had kids. I was forced to grow up basically by society, whatever you want to call it, whether it be, you know, the neighborhood I grew up in, whether it be just circumstances, whether it be, you know, life itself. I was forced to grow up before I had children, but a lot of guys were forced to grow up by their children.
Right.
It's almost as if their children parented them into being parents.
Right.
So watching that character, I can appreciate his storyline.
Right.
My biggest gripe, I guess, I wish they had not made Coogie so lovable from day one.
Yeah.
But I understand why somebody like him had to die.
Yeah.
To make the show the show.
Right.
You know, it still stings, though. Like, thinking about Coogie, when I think about the show, when I think about Coogie, I'm like, damn, man, why Coogie had to go, man?
Yeah.
But somebody like him had to go, though.
Especially when you see his brother trying to honor his memory by, you know, naming his truck after him, and you know, you really do kind of feel for that, you know, that character, and he I mean, but that's what it is, right? Like mm-hmm. when we look at, you know, what plays out in real life, that's what it is. That's, you know, the Trayvon Martins, we can go down the line, but that's what it is. It's like we have these young black men who don't even get a chance to flourish in life that get, you know, gunned down. Now, you know, his situation was, via some street violence, but you know, that in itself is also just kind of, you know, what we face. I mean, I think it is a very accurate portrayal of life in a big city. I mean, it harkens me back to The Wire, and you know the kind of affinity that I have for The Wire, you know, my hometown and everything, but that's what it is.
The way I explain it to people is that The Chi is The Wire for common folk, whereas The Wire was more about the streets and was more about the trap and the way it connects with everything else. While there is a street element to The Chi, it's not all about the street.
Right, okay.
It doesn't all tie back in. Well, it does tie back into street shit at times.
True.
But you're more invested in their day by day.
Right, right.
The guy is not, Brandon is Coogie's brother.
Right, right.
You're thinking Emmett.
Emmett. Okay.
Whose story I'm most interested in at this point is Ronnie. Mm-hmm. He's trying to get out of jail because his grandmother was the victim of a home invasion.
Right.
He deserves to be in jail, and he knows that. Mm-hmm. But he's trying to grapple with, making amends and for his sins while taking care of his loved ones on the outside.
Right.
And I would imagine, I've never done time, but I would imagine that that's the struggle that a lot of guys who have done time go through. It's like you're not an inherently bad person. You just made a bad decision or a bad choice. And now you have to grapple with taking accountability for your actions and still caring about folks on the outside.
Right.
A lot of people I know that have been to jail aren't bad people.
Right.
You know, they just had a situation.
Exactly.
You know, so that's another reason I care about prison reform, because not everybody that's in prison is a criminal.
Right.
I think that there's a difference between criminals and people who have committed crimes. Criminals are people who consistently and constantly commit crimes, either not always for the sake of survival, mm-hmm. but for the sake of greed, for the sake of lust, or something else. People who have committed crimes a lot of times do it out of necessity.
Right.
And I'm not mad at a guy who steals to feed his family.
Right.
I'm mad at the guy who kills and robs somebody so they can get some money to go buy some sneakers or buy some rims or something like that.
Right.
Or go buy some new guns.
Yeah.
You know.
I agree with that. I'll tell you the.
I think meth deserves 1-100 laws, just like crack got, by the way.
Well, I mean.
But we're not going to see it because,
Well.
Yeah. We already know. Yeah.
That's a problem for the poor whites.
You know, I started calling meth mayophetamine.
Yes.
Mayophetamine.
But before we head off the shot, I tell you the one part that I thought was fat, the one kind of pseudo storyline I thought was fascinating was Brandon's girlfriend.
Yeah,
in the real estate deal, right? So she's trying to sell this property or whatever, and you've got the lady on the other end who's the property owner, and she wants to sell it, and she's trying to position it as we can position this as low income housing and the owner was just like, nah, I'm not trying to have those people up in here. And I'm like those are your people.
Well, and let's be transparent for a second.
Okay.
I think that both of us know people who, while they are skin folk, they ain't our kin folk.
True. Very true.
And when you get, it seems as though, when some of us get a certain level of education, mm-hmm. a certain level of financial, footing, mm-hmm. and things of that nature, we begin to forget about the people that look like us because, we buy into the myth of bootstrapping.
Right.
I think black people buy into the myth of bootstrapping more than any other race in the world.
I agree.
I firmly believe that. And I think it's stupid to use tokenism a lot of times or anomalies as a justification for believing in it. Like, some of these guys out here are like, I made a decision. I did everything I could. Why can't they? Well, sir, what about the guy who was smarter than you that didn't get the opportunity that you got?
Right.
You know, and that happens. It's not so much that it doesn't make you a bad person to not have succeeded when someone else does. It just means that, you know, and sometimes it is a crapshoot.
Right.
Sometimes it's a lottery shoot. Like, one misstep on my end, I could be in prison.
Right.
One decision that somebody else could have made in my life could have sent me down a different path. So it's just one of those things. Like, I think that that's way more common than we're willing to admit. But also, given who her parents are,
mm-hmm.
given how they acted, and I've been treated, you know, by people as if I'm not good enough,
right?
At times, so I kind of get it,
right? I mean, I get it. I just thought it was very interesting how quickly she turned away from, you know, the conviction of her belief. And granted,
ooh, everybody got a price.
Yeah, I mean, but I understand. We all have to make those compromises sometimes. It just was a fascinating juxtaposition to see, you know, that play out, you know, in that way. So
I thought it was very interesting, like how, her parents didn't think, you know, him being an entrepreneur was good enough for their daughter. And I get it. Like, you don't ideally want your daughter to come home and say, hey, you know, yeah, we spent all these $1,000s. Of course, they had to name drop Spelman.
Right.
You know, and I'm pushing my daughter to go to Spelman. You know what I'm saying? But if my princess comes home and says, hey, daddy, I'm in love. I'm like, okay, well, let me meet homie. What does he do? He has a food truck. I'm not going to be like, okay, well, that's not necessarily my first thing that I would expect to hear or necessarily want to hear. But at the same time, if you're happy, if he treats you right, what I'm going to do is say, okay, well, where is he set up shop at? Let me go support the food truck.
Right.
Because at that point, if this is the man that's going to be taking care of my daughter or that I'm going to give my daughter's hand in marriage to, I want to make sure his business is successful.
Right.
Hey, set up shop outside of this business. You know, I've already set it up. I've already talked to the owner. Set up shop at City Hall. I already talked to that guy over there. I'm going to put you in position at that point to be successful. Instead, her parents were on some, why don't you go date this nice,
right,
you know, doctor guy?
Right.
Like, are you really trying to sell your daughter to the highest bidder?
But
it happens.
It happens all the time. But I mean, my thing is that they don't know what his, they don't like, we often sell short the fact that this dude might have a plan. Like, the food truck may be the first stop in something much larger. It could be, you know, he may have the vision of opening up a chain of food trucks, or, you know, this might be the stepping stone to, you know, getting a restaurant or some kind of other venue or expanding that business. Like, but you know, you see, like, oh, he cooks, you know, and he has a food truck, and, you know, you automatically equate that with, you know, a certain type of image. But
right,
why don't you get to know this dude and understand, like, okay, this dude has real talent. And he's trying to parlay that talent into something better and right, and be supportive of that, you know, rather than somebody who's just trying to hustle along to, you know, make a dollar out of 15 cent. You know, it's just like, you know.
And the thing is, and this is something that I'm slowly coming to terms with. In my career, you know, I have earning potential, a pretty high earning potential in my career.
Mm-hmm.
And so the thing is, with that, I could make a very, very good life for myself.
Mm-hmm.
But I've realized now that as an entrepreneur, my earning potential is somewhat infinite. As an entrepreneur, you determine how much you make by developing, pushing, branding, and building out your service line or product.
Absolutely.
And so, you know, you really are, you know, somebody else determines how much you're worth when you have a job. You right, determine how much you are worth when you're an entrepreneur.
Right. It's eat what you kill. It's simple as that. Is it, like, that was a, you know, that was a phrase that me and my boys used to use when we were in business school. You know, if you want to go to entrepreneur, yay, you go eat what you kill. Some people can't do that. I mean, what people have to realize is that not everybody's built for this entrepreneurial life.
I'm diving into it, man.
Right. You know, not everybody's built, you know, to take that risk. I mean, it's a risk, and, you know, no amount of planning sometimes can circumvent that risk.
It's feast and famine sometimes.
Right. You know, sometimes, hey, you got a great month and or a great year, and then sometimes the cupboard's bare.
One thing I want to do, and we've talked about this on the show, and I kind of let it go. I want to talk to more black entrepreneurs.
Let's do it.
I want us to have entrepreneurs like sit in here and talk about their entrepreneurial journey, because I think we need to return to black entrepreneurship. Now, I get it that not everybody is built for entrepreneur life, like you said. Mm-hmm. But I do think that our community specifically needs to die. Did I say specifically just then?
No, you said you got it.
Okay,
right.
I'm just. I'm like, am I drunk?
No,
like,
no.
Okay.
We only one in.
I'm tripping.
We only one in.
So, okay, we good. Now, by the end of the show, when we got three in the piece, it's like, hey. You can tell. But no. It's one of those things where I've been reading Jay Prince's book, The Art and Science of Respect.
Shout out to Jay Prince.
Man. James Prince, it's almost like reading Rich Dad Poor Dad for like real niggas. That's what Jay Prince's book is. It's Rich Dad Poor Dad for real niggas. Like, that's what it is, dog. Like, you can't really.
That is the line of the day.
Oh my God, that's gonna be the title of this episode. Yeah. Rich Dad Poor Dad for real niggas. Like, for real. Oh my God. Anyway, so as I'm reading Rich Dad Poor Dad for real niggas, I'm realizing exactly how much, and I've always said this jokingly, but I've always meant it. I've always said that like some of your most entrepreneurial, most intelligent leaders and businessmen got their education in the streets.
Right.
To be, and I hate to say this, because it's so stereotypical, but to be a drug kingpin, you have to have a CEO mind frame.
True.
To even be a decent drug dealer, you know, you have to have decent leadership skills and understand certain things about logistics, about business, about, you know, points of reconciliation and all that kind of stuff. Like, there are things you have to understand, business principles that you learn, you know, from the streets. And so, and the School of Hard Knocks, to some people, is the best school for them to learn in. And it's more expensive than Harvard.
Right.
I tell people that all the time. You know, to get an education in the streets is more expensive than getting an education in college. Because while going to college may cost you some money, getting that education in the streets may cost you your life.
True.
And so the thing is about it, I don't encourage and have never encouraged anyone to get that education. What I've always done, though, is encourage people who are in the streets, much like Killer Mike does, is to, if you're going to be out here moving this way, let's find some ways for you to take that money and be able to go legit.
Right.
You know, let's open you some cash-heavy businesses so that you don't necessarily, you know, mask that money, but you can put it into it, make decent money, and then when it's time for you to walk away from that, walk away from it and still be set.
Right. So I think we need to take it a step deeper, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, my frame of reference is kind of framed by experience I had this past weekend. Again, was in D.C., had the opportunity to go back to the African American History Museum. If you have not been, you need to go. It is I cannot stress enough that if you ever find yourself in D.C., make plans to go see this place. First of all, it is hallowed ground. That place in its existence is long overdue. The really kind of neat thing about it is something that I just realized on this trip. It's actually right across the street from the American History Museum. So it's like we have the American History Museum, and then it was like the history. Then it's the Museum of History that y'all left out of the other one.
Oh my God, there's so many ways that you can take that.
It is phenomenal. Like, but you know, just you know, if you haven't been, you need to go. It is phenomenal. But you know, they have a section in there about black towns. And black towns that, you know, were getting started and coming up, you know, during the era of, Jim Crow time. Yeah, kind of post, you know, Civil War, Jim Crow era. Towns that were all black.
right?
Just in the middle of the country, you think, you know, we've often talked about, you know, sort of the Black Wall Street of
in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Tulsa, Oklahoma.
But there was one in Durham as well.
Exactly. And there's also, you know, been a bunch of little towns like all throughout the South and through the Midwest where, and the Southwest for that matter, that kind of sprung up. Where, you know, Black people basically did for themselves. And, you know, they harvested their dollars. They you know, you had, you know, Black doctor, Black bank, Black everything. And that's a beautiful model. But, you know, what happens to those towns? They disappear.
Right.
You know, the museum does a wonderful job of commemorating those towns and actually talking to their history and the importance that they played at that time. But likening that to today's, to where we are today, we need to have more of that. We need to have more of that. You know, we often talk about like how many times a dollar turns over within the Black community. Mm-hmm. You know, you look in the Asian community and some of these other, culturally diverse communities, you know, those dollars stay in those communities a long time before they go out.
Right.
For us, it's like 6 minutes. Like,
yeah, I think it was 6 minutes.
We get a dollar, and 6 minutes later, it's, you know, in somebody else's pocket. We need to look at ways in which we can sustain that dollar in our communities for longer, you know, and make everyone a beneficiary of that. You know, we need to get back to that way of that thought of self-sufficiency. And having, you know, basically creating our own way out of no way.
Absolutely. So in Birmingham, there's this area called Fourth Avenue. I was blessed to grow up. Birmingham is one of the blackest cities in the country, first of all.
No doubt.
And I was blessed to grow up and be nurtured in that environment. And Fourth Avenue in Birmingham was, when I was growing up, was Black Wall Street to me.
Right.
I mean, you had the Urban League, you had restaurants, you had the Carver Theater, you had the Grand Lodge of the Alabama, Prince Hall Masonic Lodge of Alabama, you had Black-owned bookstores, Black-owned restaurants, Black haberdashers, Black shoeshine shops, all that in on Fourth Avenue. And over the years, you know, it's kind of, it started going down because, you know, people started moving out of downtown and stuff like that. And now downtown is in the middle of a revitalization. And I want
gentrification.
Whatever you want to call it. And I get it. Yeah, there's some gentrification going on for sure, but it's only in small pockets in downtown,
right?
Birmingham. The mayor is very focused on ensuring that Black people have a seat at the table, no matter what goes on in Birmingham, and I can appreciate that very, very much. I want to see a revitalization of that happening of Fourth Avenue in Birmingham. I would love to go home and lead that charge, but home ain't gonna pay me.
Wait, man, so, when the dollars don't make sense.
Yeah, you know. So I'm gonna stay exactly here see if I can't lead a revolution of Black entrepreneurship here. But when you were talking about the African American History Museum being across the street from the American History Museum, the first thing that came to mind was this song.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys sign your name on the blacklist.
And know this, it's American history.
So Donnie, I don't know if people really slept on Donnie.
Yeah.
Early 2000s. Like Donnie created, this was, I think Fonte might have called it probably one of the most brave albums that anybody ever put out.
Right.
And I can agree with that because it was the it's still over almost 20 years later is one of the blackest albums I've ever heard in my life. Like it's just black as hell. Like it's like the whole album just blackity black black.
Blackity
black. I'm black y'all. I'm black y'all. I'm blackity black and I'm black y'all. Like that's that album, but I loved it. I loved it. And people don't realize, like, he's still putting stuff out here and there.
Yeah. I mean,
I loved it. Donnie's Donnie, man. Donnie put out some stuff, I want to say last year, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, man. We've got some artists out here that actually do put out great music. I mean, but, you know, I think about how long it took for like the, like I said, like the commons and the, you know, to catch on and you know these guys that actually have a message. I mean, is not meant for, you know, public consumption. It's not meant for a certain population of the listening, you know, audience.
So in 2002, like, so a lot of stuff is going on now, and this is the people thought I was crazy mm-hmm. back then, because I was trying to be dapped from school days, like I was super woke. You know, I was out there telling people, man, look, the university is trying to, you know, blah blah blah. Like I was banging on the system, and Donnie is constantly playing in my ear 2002, and now it's cool to be woke. You know,
right?
It wasn't ever cool to be woke when I was coming up. People looked at me like I was insane. Like people literally thought I was crazy. And Donnie in 2002 on an album on major release said, I'm not a nigga, I'm a negro. When I see a nigga, I'll let you know.
Hey.
And I was like, he almost made me stop using the N-word.
Right.
Paul Mooney is who kept me saying the N-word. Paul Mooney said, I'm not gonna stop saying nigga.
The good angel and bad angel?
Yeah. Paul Mooney said, I say nigga 50 times a day before I leave the house because it keep my teeth white. So, no, I don't use it nearly as much as I used to. But Donnie is like, he was just so brave. And so, but the thing is, our history is American history. There would be no America without us.
Dude, there is nothing more evident by going into that museum and realizing that just that fact, that America would not exist if not for the black and brown folks that built this country for free.
Now, with that being said, we got to step into the next topic.
Okay.
And this is the perfect segue for that topic.
Uh-oh.
You know when you hear that one chord in the crowd?
Yep.
You don't know who it is. Most of the time,
mm-hmm.
unless you know what you're playing.
Right.
But you about to know exactly who this is.
Hey. Lift every voice and I'm about to put a fist in the air.
Y'all can't tell me that Beyonce ain't the GOAT, dog.
Yo,
I am officially a member of the Beehive.
The Beehive gained two new members.
Bro.
Make room on the bus. We coming on board.
Yo, I am so a member of the Beehive now. Like, you can't watch, and I haven't even seen the whole thing. Like, but Beyonce's homecoming?
Yeah.
Bro, it's just, it... Damn it, man.
So first of all, I'm glad you brought this up, because I got a topic to follow this one that we can hit on in a second. But I want to talk about let's just talk about the pure optics of this performance. First of all, for those of you that don't know, and I don't know why I'm even saying that, because anybody that listens to this podcast knows exactly what's going on. This performance was done last year at Coachella, which...
Beychella,
which we will now rename it.
This year was Glovercella.
Yeah.
Because Donald Glover did his thing.
Yeah.
It wasn't Beyonce.
No.
But Donald Glover did his thing.
But here's the thing. You know, I don't know some of y'all might not, you'll be, you know, intimately familiar with Coachella. It's this big music festival that happens out in, I think, the desert of California. But every year
it's very white.
very white.
But they tend to enjoy black headliners, you know, and mid-major acts.
You know, because that's what we can do.
Because Cardi performed last year, I think, too.
Yeah, you know, but because that's what we can do. But I digress. Her show was built around an HBCU, on a HBCU theme. I just want y'all to think about that for a second. You know, just think about, like, you're in this white...
you're surrounded by Mayo sapiens.
Yes. Just all the caucasity in the world surrounding you. And you go out there,
The air smells of patchouli and peyote.
And bad weed.
And somebody pissed on their leg while waiting on B.
Just because, you know.
You might smell urine in the distance.
Yeah, but, you know, we all out here loving each other, whatever.
Yeah.
But I just want y'all to think about just how that come the first chord she hits is the black national anthem.
Well, this came okay. So she did the welcome. She did Crazy in Love.
Right.
So she was gonna do Crazy in Love because that's one of her biggest hits.
Right.
Right. And which is understandable. But when she came with Freedom, then came with Lift Every Voice and Sing,
dude.
And then told y'all to get information back to back to back. And that's in the beginning.
Right.
Of the set. Whew.
Yo.
Man.
For real? Like
B is the GOAT.
Yo. So let's talk about that.
Okay.
All right. So
Let's dive into it.
So Ariana Grande.
Grande.
She might, I don't know what she is, but whatever. I think she's very white, but anyway.
Oh, yeah, she's Caucasian as hell. Now, okay. I'm not going to take that from her.
So I saw somewhere, I think she was paid $8 million for her performance at Coachella, either this year or last year or whatever. They paid Beyonce, I think, $4 million for her performance. However,
mm-hmm.
she got the rights to record her performance
mm-hmm.
and to distribute it under her name and flip that $4 million into 60.
Beyonce the GOAT.
That's GOAT. That's GOAT status right there. You can't even argue. You can't even argue with how much of a player she is, man. Here's another thing. They were trying, so Reebok, right? She went out, you know, was they were pitching.
Wait, let's stop for a second.
Okay.
So I'm looking at the route. I wanted to go back and double check because I thought I read something about Ariana and Beyonce. According to the folks at Variety, Ariana made $8 million and B made $4 million. Now, don't get me wrong. Ariana can sing. She's still very Caucasian, but she can sing. She's not Beyonce.
Not.
According to a couple of other sources, though, each artist was paid the same amount for 2 weekends worth of shows. Each made $4 million per show for each weekend.
Okay.
So that first weekend, they made $4 million. That second weekend, they made $4
million. Okay.
So maybe they did make both, but that boss move Beyonce made?
Right.
Still blew it out the water.
Right. I mean, just think about that. That, you know, I mean, just think about, like, how that what kind of... First of all, the business acumen of her and her team is phenomenal, right?
Yeah.
That, I mean, to go in there and say, look, I'll come in here and perform. Y'all pay me whatever, but I want the rights.
And Coachella wanted Bey.
Right.
Because they know Beyonce's folks will buy those tickets.
Oh, right. Yeah, they knew they were going to sell it out.
And they travel.
Yeah. I mean, hell, the whole thing was a plot line in Insecure.
So yeah, it was a plot line. I just thought about that. Side note, Insecure will not be back until 2021.
Fuck that.
Or is it 2020? 2020. It will not be back to 2020. I'm sorry.
Fuck that too.
Yeah, it won't be back to 2020.
I'm Lawrence Hive over here. But anyway.
Shout out to Lawrence Hive.
Shout out.
Okay, so this is what I want us to do. All right. This is going to sound real trash for two dudes to do this, but we're going to do it anyway.
Okay.
All right. Every month, we're going to put some money aside, right?
Okay.
And when Beyonce has a tour, we're going to have that money ready to go.
Hey.
So that we can have VIP tickets for us and our significant others, and we all going to go to see Beyonce.
Let's do it.
All right.
Let's do it.
I don't have a significant other anymore, so.
We're going to work on that. We'll, you got time. Yeah, you got time.
I got time.
But I mean, just the optics of that deal, man. Sad. That's crazy.
Let me drink some more. I just got sad.
Pass me another. Yeah. Slowing down over here. But I mean, just the pure, you know, just the business sense. Like the Carter family, man.
They the best.
They the new Bumpy Johnsons, man.
I called Hove the president of hip hop.
He is the president, CEO, chairman of the board. He got it all. Like, I mean, and the great thing and the amazing thing about it all is that he's passing that knowledge on, dog.
Yeah.
Passing it on.
I love it.
It's beautiful to see. He's out here with these dudes telling, like, here's how you need to J. Cole and all these guys, you know, taking them under his wing, passing knowledge on. We so often live in a culture where, you know, I get mine and I'm a do what I can to hold on to it.
To hold on to it and not share.
And you can't get yours because I got it. But he's sharing the wealth, man. Here's rising tide raises all ships.
He's been doing it since Reasonable Doubt.
Exactly.
And people didn't realize, I didn't realize it until I want to say Volume 2. And that's when I really started paying. I didn't start paying attention to Jay until Volume 2. I did have Reasonable Doubt. I had the original Reasonable Doubt. That was the blue disc.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people didn't have the original blue disc, but I liked what he had to say.
Right.
And so I copped it. Volume 2 is when I really, really started paying attention, because that's when he came to the South to get hot.
Right.
He got with Bun B and Pimp mm-hmm. C and made Big Pimpin'.
Right.
He got with Juvenile and made We Ride. You know, right. He was showing love to Scarface.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And so the thing is like, once I started paying attention to what he was saying as opposed to just the bops that I liked, I was like, man, yo, this dude say he the greatest. Like, nah, Jay really is.
Yeah.
He really is the greatest. And so the thing is, like, I know a lot of feminists and womanists didn't care for 444, but you have to understand that from a traditional standpoint, 444 was a lot of men's lemonade. It talked about, it was his most vulnerable album.
Right.
And a lot of times we get shit on for saying, hey, yeah, you know, we were existing. A lot of us did exist in this space that may not be considered the healthiest space, but that's still a reality of black manhood across this country.
True.
And so if we aren't given room to share our truth and to express our truth, then what the fuck do we have platforms for?
I mean,
and so that's what I love about Jay, is that he has grown up in front of our very eyes and even admitted that at 40 something years old, he still had growing up to do.
Right.
And I appreciated that.
I mean, the beautiful thing. So I don't understand all the disgust by anyone over 444.
Well,
I
thought it's because it's B, first of all.
Okay,
and
whatever.
And I get what you're saying, but nobody in the Beehive wants to give Jay any sort of country or leeway for ever cheating on B.
Okay, look, man.
And we get it. It's not our world.
Right. And here's the other thing. Y'all need to stay out of their relationship.
Them some grown ass. Like, the thing is.
If they want to be together, let them be together. Like,
Bruh, look, hey. They sang all them anthems about, you know, how, you know, you better call Becky with the good hair and all that. And then ignored the fact that she still went back to that dude.
Right. Exactly.
She didn't give up on him.
Exactly.
She said that, in my logic is, no matter what, short of certain things, if we can talk about it, we can talk through it.
Right.
And that's what they did. Beyonce and Jay are indirectly teaching us what both healthy and unhealthy relationships look like. Jay told you what an unhealthy mentality was in a relationship. B showed you what an unhealthy mentality was in a relationship. And then at the end, through their actions, they showed you what a healthy relationship looks like.
Right.
Now, I'm never one to be like, black women should, you know, sacrifice themselves at the altar of any nigga's wayward dick. Like, I've never been that guy. But at the same time, you know, sometimes you start off in a toxic relationship
and you have to pull the toxicity out of each other to become healthy.
Right. But here's the thing.
And that's not me saying that Beyonce was toxic in any way.
No, not at all. Not
please,
all.
You know, leave me alone. Don't come for me.
Don't be. Stay. Stay at bay.
You send your boyfriend after me. I'm gonna slap him in public. Slap him smooth out his Tim. Don't play with me. I wear Amex for a reason, nigga.
With a brick.
I'm trying to tell you. And I got shop gloves, nigga. I got heavy hands.
You gonna get deboed.
I steal bikes, nigga.
Anyway, I'm sorry. But here's the thing about, you know, 444. You have to respect. Here's the thing about Jay-Z's career, as specifically as it relates to 444. You have to respect the fact that he has grown up in front of all of our eyes and has openly acknowledged his fuck ups.
Yeah.
Has everyone.
I mean, you got people.
I was just hollering at the girls. I was going to come right back. Come on, man. Like,
we have people in our lives that can't even privately acknowledge their fuck ups.
Right.
So for this guy to literally be, I guess, strong enough to display his fuck ups to the whole world, for Beyonce
right.
to be literally be the baddest chick in the game
right.
and expose, you know, the weaknesses in her relationship to the world. There's a level of vulnerability there that, my God, like, I can't even imagine.
Right. It's not just the relationship piece. It's him as an individual. You look at, you know, I could have bought this place in Dumbo for like $2 million. You know,
turn right
back around. You know, you know, like he's telling you, like,
yeah, I screwed up big time.
I've fucked up in my life, right? And he's doing it in a public forum. I mean, he's going to the center of the town square and yelling this thing
and letting y'all have it
and letting y'all know, like, yeah, I fucked up, but the thing is, I learned and I've corrected my actions and
I grew from that.
Right.
You know,
growth.
I'm no longer that same dude.
Right. You know, my thing is, you know, you look at what they've done together and you look at, you know.
Did you know Jay is worth $900 million?
I mean, it doesn't surprise me.
I am shook. I got to get on my grind, dog.
Dude.
Like, I am shook.
Who
right
are you telling?
Now.
I mean, but I mean, look, man. First of all, you can't deny, like, that is the perfect example of somebody taking talent, pure God-given talent, and parlaying that into opportunity, parlaying that into success, parlaying that success into generational wealth and generational knowledge, and parlaying that generational wealth and generational knowledge into lessons for the next coming up behind.
Right.
Dude, that's what it's all about.
You can't beat it.
Don't hide it, divide it. You know, you gotta, you know, get those lessons you learn, you have to pass them on or else it's not doing anybody any good. I mean, yeah, you're winning, but, you know, how does that help?
Nobody wins when the family feuds.
Woo! Yes,
he
sir.
Said, what's better than one millionaire?
Two.
Especially when they're the same hue as you. Yo, Jay is that dude, man. Like, I'm sorry. I've said multiple times that there is a Jay-Z line for whatever you're going through in life, there's a Jay-Z line for it. And I really do believe that.
Facts.
This is going to sound really trash, but I had a professor ask me this once upon a time. He said, a thousand years from now. He said, when our civilization has crumbled and people are looking for artifacts, who do you think that they'll find and will try to deify? And the only people I could legitimately say were Tupac because of his volume of work. Biggie because of his limited volume of work would be more like a John the Baptist type. And I said it would be Tupac and it would be Jay-Z if it was hip-hop, period.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't look at anybody else and put them in that realm. You can't. Well, I wanted to talk about American descendants of slaves, but we only got about 6 minutes left.
Oh.
So I don't think that's enough time that to really dive into time. It. That's so you want to do that for the next episode?
We'll do that for the next one. But can I bring up a topic real quick?
Absolutely, absolutely.
All right, so because
I got three short ones that I want to throw at you.
All right, let's do those. About. Let's do those.
All right, so first of all, you know the song by City Girls, "Act Up." You can get smacked up.
Right.
You know Lil Yachty wrote that?
No.
Yeah, Lil Boat wrote that.
Oh.
Yeah, I was impressed.
Hey.
But you know what? When I start looking at the lyrics, listen to the lyrics, and listen to the cadence, I'm like, yeah, that's Lil Boat. that's all Lil Boat right there.
Right, right.
Avengers Endgame. You going to see it?
I have to for the show, for the culture.
Well, you know, it's 3 hours long.
I got time.
And so
I'll make time.
And so number one. And number two, there's a tweet that was on Twitter, and I completely agree with it. I'm paraphrasing, of course, but growing up in a Pentecostal church has prepared me for this moment my whole life. Sitting through 3 hours of Avengers Endgame. I mean, I was back home, and my dad, he still preaches. He invited me to this church service. He basically bullied us all, the whole family, into coming to this program. And so I got back here, like, driving 6.5 hours. I was exhausted. I woke up the next morning. I didn't go to the gym. I was like, screw this. I'm going to go to work, and I'm going to go late. And my boss was in town. I was like, he's going to have to understand.
Yeah.
I don't give a damn. I'm coming in when I feel like
right.
Who going to check me?
Hey.
You know what I'm saying?
I grew up Catholic, so I don't know what that's like.
Oh,
I
mean, man. So you
Crafters of religion, baby. In and out in about an hour.
Man, y'all had them 45-minute services on Super Bowl Sunday.
Right. I got to go. I got wings to make.
Last but not least, us.
Ooh.
We haven't talked about it on the show.
We have not talked about it on the
so
show.
So you want to? So I know we kind of behind the curve, but you want to wait for it. We want to say that to the next episode too, because I think we're gonna have a good conversation about that.
We need to peel back the onion on that.
All right. So what was the topic you had just now?
All right. So real quick. So again, in DC this past weekend, evidently there's an issue with some gentrifiers.
You ragged ass, low down, dirty, mayo sapien bitches. You. Fucking with go-go music like that. I hope, bitch, you can drive 10 minutes to the south and be somewhere and still have something just as nice and stop fucking with them people in their go-go music, you raggedy bitch, you.
So
I'm sorry.
Tell
them what's going on. I got mad about that.
I'm going to move past the go-go because I got a new one for you. So evidently, I don't know how many people of y'all are familiar with the Howard University.
The
Howard University.
The only other HBCU I know that calls himself the is... Well, I don't even know if they call themselves the, but I know the Tennessee State University, they call themselves that. Mm-hmm. But also, Jackson State says the I love because that's part of their alma mater song.
Okay.
And everybody always takes that and says, you know, they make it a double entendre, says the Jackson State University. I love that. I love Jackson State, by the way. Shout out to Jackson State.
Shout out to Jackson
Sonic
State.
Boom with the South.
Word. So, apparently these colonizers have moved into the area. And I don't know, like, you know, Florida Avenue... you know, the whole area around Howard University traditionally has been a not nice area. You know, it's a black school in a black city.
Yeah, I mean, but black ass.
Say no
HBCUs
more.
Always be in the hood though.
Right.
I don't know. Well, many it ain't, bro.
True. But anyway, my point being,
unless they're rural.
Okay.
Because Tuskegee ain't really in the hood.
Yeah.
So.
Anyway. Yeah. Point being, so they've done a lot of gentrifying in the area, and you've had some colonizers move in. And
doing what they do, colonizing, you raggedy.
Exactly.
Bitches,
yeah. And so the point was that they've been walking their dogs through the yard, allowing the dogs to shit everywhere.
Stay the fuck off our campuses, you bastards.
And when they interview one of these dudes, he said...
I get really upset about this.
No, but
sorry.
No. Here's what's really going to make you mad. So when they interviewed the one of the dudes about it, he said they should move the campus.
That's going to do it for us here at the Council Podcast. I'm actually on the way to Washington, D.C. at this very moment. To go find this motherfucker and move him my motherfucking self. How dare you? You entitled sack. You know what? I mean
we can dig into it next time.
I'm about to get in my bag. Like, please, please don't do this to me right now. Like I wanna get in my bag so bad.
Why don't we save it for next time?
Because this, that shit there, sir.
That shit there, nigga.
That shit there, here, nigga. That shit here, nigga. Here, right. Here, my nigga. Like, that shit there, bro. Like, come on, dog.
Dude.
Get your raggedy bitch, boy. Ooh.
Dude.
I can't. you know you mad when you can't even get all your words out.
Right. Dude. So, like, that's, you know, and it was telling because I actually, Friday night was driving back to my brother's place, and we actually drove past Howard. So, first of all, you know, shout out to HU.
The real HU.
Well,
as they call it. I can't say that.
I ain't going to say that.
They call it the real HU.
I got some peoples that go to the other HU.
Shout out to my folk from Hampton. Also the real HU.
Shout out to all my HBCU grads and people in school. We love y'all.
And shout out to Hofstra. The other HU.
Just because.
We doing all the HUs.
First of all, shout out to my boy who's playing lacrosse up there. My boy, word. Sterling Arger. He from Charlotte, North Carolina. Shout out to you. His dad is frat. Dude is starting as a freshman.
Hey man, you got to teach me how to play lacrosse, dog. I got to get my lung capacity up first.
No, you don't.
I hadn't ran in years.
No, you don't. Just come on out, man.
I got bad knees.
You let me know. Go out, hit somebody.
Hey, don't tell me that.
But
because I forget we playing lacrosse, we playing football. You can't Lawrence Taylor somebody out here. Why the fuck not? He got pads on.
Shit, ain't that kind of pads.
Hey, we played this shit in high school. Throw up tackle, nigga. Fuck you mean? Sorry.
But yeah, it was again, shout out to all the HBCU people out there. We love y'all. From the PWIs out here.
Yeah, man.
And I guess, you know, just leaving off.
I'm still depressed about the fact that North Carolina A&T rejected my application because I had a criminal conviction, like, 14 years ago. It wasn't even a felony. Like, I don't even think it was, like, a misdemeanor. It was, like, a violation or something. Like, yeah. That shit broke my heart. It really broke my heart. I was really looking forward to having an A&T degree on my wall.
I can understand.
Like, A&T was my first
choice. Everybody that I know that has gone there has, I've never heard anyone that has gone there say a bad word about it.
A&T was my first choice.
I actually went to GHOE 1 year.
G-Ho.
G-Ho. Got out there 1 year while I was in B school. Look, man, we just, bros was just road tripping. We were like, hey, let's take the trip. And dude had a blast.
So but shout out to A&T nonetheless.
Shout out to A&T. Shout out to Howard. Shout out to This Is Beta. y'all bros. Shout out to y'all and the new boys y'all brought in.
Blame Beta.
Yeah, exactly.
Also, I want to give a shout out to your alma mater, Just Cause. And I ended up selecting my third choice.
Okay.
Hey, man, you always got to have options, all right? So, hey, it just kind of is what it is.
The only thing worth value in this life is options.
Facts. So that's going to do it for us here at the Country Podcast. I was going to play a song from the 80s from before I was born to close out the show. But instead, all this talk about Jay-Z and Beyonce and all that got me thinking that we should play something else. So, matter of fact, I pulled up my Tidal app, and we're going to play. I just decided to change the song at the last second.
Sorry. This is real time.
This is, yeah.
Real time changes.
This is where we at.
We live.
This is where we at with
it. Fuck it, we do it live.
This is where we at with it. So, I'm going to play this. This is one of my favorite songs of all time, whether it be J&B or anybody, like just... No matter what the artist, this is literally one of my favorite songs of all time. We're going to use it to close it out. It's a part two, On the Run, J&B. Y'all already know what it is, man. We'll check y'all next week. Peace.
Peace.
Who wants that perfect love story anyway? Cliche, 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 cliche. Who wants that hero love that saves the day? Anyway, cliche, 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 cliche. What about the bad guy goes good? Yeah. And in the
hourglass, toast to cliches in the dark past. Toast to cliches in the dark past.
You against the world, then so be it.
I don't care if they give me life.